So we're going to talk about our work focusing on population mobility, and I think it follows on quite nicely from Dominic's talk in providing some extra tools to support malaria elimination planning. So malaria elimination, we've heard a bit about this already. These are the countries in light blue that have a national policy for moving towards eliminating malaria, and I think some of those Mekong region countries could probably be coloured blue as well nowadays. Apologies for the UK drifting north there. I'm not sure what happened. It's a good way to make you safe from malaria is to drift further north. I'm going to talk about some of the challenges that these different countries are facing in terms of measuring incidents, mapping transmission foci, testing interventions, and elimination strategy design. So first of all, just measuring incidents here, we have recommendations from the WHO. When you get to elimination, pre-elimination stage, you should be mapping or measuring incidents, the cases per 1,000 population a year. So this involves, for instance, taking individual health facility records, counting the number of cases. You get your denominator from the census there. This is pinned to the wall of the health facility. This is from northern Namibia. And then combining all of that data together, you can get a map of incidents. So all seems straightforward. The other factor here, mapping transmission foci. Maybe you have three villages here. You've looked at the cases that are being reported to the health facilities, done prevalence surveys. In each case, this village in the middle there comes out as our transmission foci. It's got a much higher number of cases, higher prevalence. Seems straightforward. Intervention study design. Maybe you want to test the ability of mass drug administration. This is some examples that the Gates Foundation are supporting here to testing these approaches as a complement to standard interventions, and then comparing those results to neighbouring regions to see what kind of effect size they have. And elimination strategy design. So maybe we've, just like Dominic mentioned, maybe we've got our 10 million, we've mapped out where our focal transmission areas are, and our strategy might be, we see there's some hotspots there, so maybe we nuke that area, that hotspot first in January, where we then move on, nuke that area in March. Very simplified design here, but it's a strategy we could take. The problem is populations don't just sit on their bums all the time. They are highly dynamic. So this is some data from some mobile phone records. I'll talk about a lot in this talk. This is just a sample of 500,000 anonymous mobile phone users and their movement patterns out of Abidjan over 6 months. And some of those movements you can see is up to a million trips are made to other parts in the country, just over 6 months from 500,000 people. Equally, we can in fact see some movements from space. There are such huge seasonal migrations in Niger here, in northern Nigeria, that we can actually see some areas of cities getting brighter as migrants move in, turn on lights, start fires. So there's a huge amount of movement going on in many of these settings that we are interested in. So how does that change the way we think about these challenges? Measuring incidents, for instance, we are in each case here relying on a static denominator, assuming that just stays the same throughout the entire year, when in actual fact those denominators can be changing hugely, and that may change our estimates of incidents. Those transmission foci, in actual fact, that village may be seeing much higher levels of cases, higher prevalence, because many of the villagers work in the forest or in some of these marshy areas where they're acquiring infections, and the actual transmission foci may be somewhere else. Intervention study designs. In actual fact, some of these areas that we're trying to compare to neighbours are highly connected to those neighbours. Huge amounts of movements to other parts of the region and other parts of the country where transmission may be higher and parasites may be introduced, moving around all the time, and make it difficult for us to assess how comprehensive, how effective those interventions are. Then our elimination strategy design, you can guess this, it's probably not the best strategy design because population movements are resulting in reinfestation. And there's an example from this in Haiti where they did try and clear out parasites, I think in the 60s, move on to another area, and people moved. Moving around just reintroduced those parasites, and you're kind of chasing your tail. There's a map of those movements in Haiti, and it's quite a highly connected place. So this is great, but does this human mobility really influence malaria dynamics that much? We're seeing an increasing number of case studies throughout the literature highlighting quite how important mobility is. So I'll just draw out a couple of these. This is one recently from Malaria Journal and by Bioko Island. They looked at travel to the mainland, which was higher transmission. They have an ambition of elimination on Bioko Island in Equatorial Guinea. How much did this movement affect their elimination ambitions? Well, perhaps unsurprisingly, children and adults who had recently travelled to the mainland were twice as likely to be infected. But perhaps the really interesting result that came out was even those who didn't travel at all, these children and adults, were four times likely to be infected if they lived in areas that had a higher proportion of travellers. So those travellers going to the mainland, becoming infected and bringing back infections are sustaining transmission even in those populations that don't travel. And a similar example here, a recent paper by Caroline Lynch in the Ugandan highlands, who are interested in how much does travel contribute to transmission in these highland areas and highland fringe areas. In a case control study, those patients that travel to areas of higher transmission in their home area were seven times more likely to have confirmed malaria. And it's feasible that this travel and introduction of parasites is sustaining transmission in some of these highland areas. Equally, in elimination settings, population movements become increasingly important. There's an example there from Saudi Arabia. As the number of confirmed local cases drops, the percentage of imported cases increase. And all of those countries that have got close to elimination in the past, and have stopped control measures, they were getting either run out of money or thought they'd succeeded. Malaria came roaring back and often spread throughout the countries by population movements. So movements seem to be pretty important. How can we measure it? Ideally, we should measure parasite movement as the kind of techniques that David and Dominic talked about already. And ideally, if we could do that kind of analysis everywhere, it would be fantastic. And these genetic approaches are offering promise. In many of these countries, we don't quite yet have the funds, maybe the techniques to do a cross-country sampling of these populations. I think soon we may get there, but at the moment, human movement as a proxy is more scalable and cost-effective. So how do we measure human movement? There are very, very many different types of human movement, and they all have different impacts on the way the parasites are moved around. This is just... for vector-borne diseases in general and the kind of impacts they have in terms of your daily commute to school or international travel causing the global spread of some of these parasites. And pre-21st century, we kind of had three major methods for measuring human movement. We had, on the top right there, census data, which asked questions about where did you live a year ago, from which long-term movements could be inferred. We had in the middle there, border crossing information, counting the number of cars, people that are crossing a border, often pretty unreliable in some of the settings we're interested here, where there are porous borders. And then a very useful source of data that's still widely used today is travel history surveys, which gives us, for a small areas, a very detailed picture on how populations travel and their demographics. There are also today, we can add more and more different types of data to this. So increasingly there are very detailed statistics on flight passengers as that becomes the more important measure of method of travel, shipping statistics. We have kind of proxy measures of population movements, whether that's measured through the satellite nightlights I mentioned, as movements through banknote flows at the top right there, and then proxies in terms of travel times and as an assumption that those travel times influence how populations move. In the bottom left there, we have the more detailed scale of the spectrum there, giving people individual GPS units to understand how they're moving around, that can get around some of the problems of recall bias from household questionnaires. And increasingly things that from social media, from Twitter, from Facebook, methods are being tested for movement patterns. But what I'll talk about mostly is this data set that is covering probably the largest area of the spectrum here, which is anonymized mobile phone call data records, which are providing quite a nice complementary data set to some of these. So what I mean by this is if your eye were to make a call at this location now, that would be routed through the nearest tower that's maybe on top of this building. The network operator records that time and tower location for billing purposes. If we were then to move somewhere else in London and make another call, that information would then be recorded of which tower that call was routed through, and you would get information that I had moved from one location to another. If we think about how rapidly mobile phones have taken off in across the world, we can get movement patterns of millions of people across detailed spatial and temporal scales that we've never really been able to measure before. So this is an example of mapped movements from Côte d'Ivoire. And this is the focus of a Flowminder Foundation, which we've set up a few years ago, which is now working with a range of mobile operators around the world and a range of focuses in terms of research objectives. And many of those focus around malaria elimination and supporting malaria control programs in different settings. And also not only using the data directly, but building models based on these type of data to infer movement patterns in areas where this data is not so readily available. And models that can be more easily shared than these type of data. So there's obviously problems with these data. We can provide pages and pages of problems and issues with these type of data. And some of the most obvious ones are the fact that mobile phone penetration has not completely covered many of these countries. We see here, although some of these surveys are quite old, we see that there is still a bias towards those richer populations. But that's becoming increasingly less of a bias. Even here, we've got South Africa, Egypt, Nigeria, mobile phone subscriptions per 100 inhabitants. And even in Nigeria there, we're getting up to about 95% of the population. And soon there'll be more mobile phones than population in Africa. So these biases exist. There's been some studies to look at the impact of them on population mobility, showing that depending on the question you're asking, they can have limited impact. That obviously if you're studying the most lowest population, the lowest asset-based quintiles, you've got to account for that uncertainty in better ways than if you're doing a population-level mobility. And there's importance of integration with other types of data set, including genetic data, is obviously a key for understanding the parasite movement. So let's go back to those elimination challenges and go through each one just to illustrate how these kind of data can provide some support. So measuring incidents. We talked about the fact that these denominators are actually quite dynamic. We may be able to get better and better data on the cases, but what about the population that those cases are coming from? So the WorldPop project has been run for a number of years out of Southampton, and is I think we're doing a pretty good job of mapping these denominators statically, and we're increasingly scaling that up with support from the Microsoft guys here today to provide these detailed population maps. But they are a static picture. We know that populations move around a lot. So what can we do? We can make use of these phone data. So this is not a malaria elimination country. It has eliminated completely. This is France. And we have census enumeration data there, the kind of best kind of data we can get for population mapping. but it's very expensive to collect and you can only get it once every decade. If we map out an account for biases in mobile usage and the user densities, we get a pretty good representation of population densities, and it lines up pretty well with the statistics there. And that's great that we can pretty much replicate the kind of accuracies we would expect from the best type of census data, but the benefit of these data is that we can map out these denominators dynamically. So this is population density differences in France between the typical workday in October and the typical day in August. The interpretation there is everyone goes to the seaside, except for within Paris. There's some peaks in Asterix Park, Disneyland, and Versailles. And we can break that down in different ways. So this is just days of the week, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, start to move into the countryside, have a nice time seeing all the beautiful countryside. Sunday, again, even more movement, and then on Monday, depressed, back to work. And this doesn't just hold for France. Some initial analyses here from Ghana showing a similar type of pattern. So there's a density change from Sunday to Wednesday, and we see this movement out to visit family, to go and do things in the weekend that we don't see in the week workday time. So we can apply that across different time scales as well, and this is an example working with the Clinton Health Access Initiative and the Namibia Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. This is Namibia, where MTC has a 96% market share, so it was quite a nice example to test things on here. This is the typical seasonality of malaria cases, and what we see, this is mapping out the population density change per square kilometre. So around December time, a huge number of people leave Windhoek, the capital, and move to the northern areas where often their families are from, just as transmission is kicking off. And then throughout the rest of the year, we see movement back to the capital. We see lots of changes going on all through the year as the transmission season is ongoing. That doesn't just occur around Christmas time. It occurs lots of changes all through the year. And we see this also in Kenya, these kind of holiday-related patterns. Here's huge amounts of movement around December-January time as well. And the focus here is obviously on getting a better denominator for our incidence mapping. So we can map out those facility catchment areas and then look at how those populations change within them from these estimates of population density. And we can see very different pictures, even from facilities that are quite close together. And not only within a year, but across years as well. So this is, although we see similar peaks at similar times of year, there are annual differences we see across these data sets. So, and the benefit of these kind of data is that they are continually being collected day by day, so we can give that more dynamic picture that Dominic mentioned. And so how does this translate into our estimates of incidence? This is estimates of incidence and how they change in terms of percentage across the entire country. So it actually reduces our estimate of incidence in December by 12% and increases it at some of those times when populations, in February, March time, when they are moving back around the time of transmission. And subnationally, this has a very different picture as well. So some of those areas we're estimating that incidence is perhaps 30% less than it is in the more standard methods that the program is using. So mapping transmission foci is another aspect. So just a conceptual model here. This is village A, where maybe there's some moderate level of transmission left. But those populations spend time in other places. Maybe they go away to work in some agricultural areas where there's a lot higher levels of transmission, or forested areas. Maybe they spend time in urban areas where there is no transmission. And so this population maybe spends some significant proportions of its time elsewhere and acquiring infections elsewhere. So that when we go to take data from the health facilities, Some proportion of those cases may be required actually at location B. Or we go and do a community prevalence survey. Some proportion of that those infections may have been acquired elsewhere. So when we are looking at the existing incidence and prevalence map, they're representing that's a mixed picture of local and imported infections. And if we want to try and target areas for elimination, we want to really know where's the true transmission foci, where are those infections actually being acquired. So this is where the mobility data can come in a transmission model to back calculate from our measured transmission map down to ultimately taking steps backwards to work out where people are spending their time. And in actual fact, our estimates here are that some of those areas in green are perhaps only supporting transmission because of population movement back and forward between different areas. So the third part here, testing interventions, and this is just a simple example here from Namibia. This is mapping out all of those movements. This is just a 1 year's worth of data, translates to 19 billion mobile phone calls and texts. If we take just one region here in the north, Oshikati, and look at the general population movements, we see that the residents actually travel to certain places far more than others. And some of the largest travel volumes are obviously to some of the neighbouring settlements. So if we are thinking about designing an intervention study where we're conducting maybe a mass drug administration intervention in one settlement and comparing it to another area, it's perhaps not the most sensible thing to do given our knowledge of how much people move back and forward between the two. And this kind of data allows us to support the design of these case control pairings and rethinking where we can best target those. So in this case, a pairing of this other settlement in Dunja with Oshikati makes a lot more sense because there's not such a strong connection between them. And we can do this across countries at different spatial and temporal scales. So this is the movement data for Namibia. If we identify using some network clustering methods, those areas that are the same colour have a lot more movement between them than they do to the neighbouring colours. So it's identifying which areas could potentially collaborate, which areas are more connected and which ones are more isolated. So back to our example there, this is the community that could be defined for that northern Namibia simple example here, where choosing pairs of communities within this community where there is lots of movement doesn't make so much sense. The final section, our elimination strategy design. Given Dominic's example, maybe we have 10 million, maybe the Gates Foundation has 200 million to think about planning elimination. We don't have the resources still to hit everywhere all at once. So which areas are so strongly connected by movement that perhaps a coordinated approach is likely required? We can't move from one area, clear out the parasites, and move on to another one, and expect things to stay eliminated. So are there actually isolated areas as well where parasites could be cleared with potentially low rates of reintroduction? Again, this mobility data can give us some guidance on where we might be able to do this kind of targeting. So here's the map I showed earlier of the positivity rate in Haiti. Here's the daily probabilities of populations moving in and out of these areas. Yeah, if we do this kind of clustering approach, it identifies four quite strongly connected regions where there is lots of movement within them, but they're quite isolated in terms of movement between those communities. And yeah, within those, we can identify areas of higher transmission and lower transmission, those areas that may be the sources within those regions that we could target. Global eradication planning, this is a much more of a tricky situation, but the Gates Foundation is interested in this, and it requires a regionally coordinated approach. So how do we define those regions to account for this mobility? We're not going to get this cell phone type data everywhere, maybe we will ultimately. In this case, we were just interested in, does this census-based migration data give a good proxy for how strongly connected different regions are? Compared to the phone data, it does. I mean, where you move to on shorter scales is often where you have migrated to or from. So we can start to at least link together the transmission data from the Malaria Atlas project with some migration data to look at. There are actually some quite strongly connected communities that pop out again in terms of national level, and these line up quite well with various resistance data. We have similar things with HIV subtype markers, where we see that some areas are quite strongly connected, and parasites, drug resistance, HIV subtypes are moving a lot within those areas, but not so much between those areas. This gives us some information to infer how we should divide up the world in terms of planning for this global eradication. And we're increasingly starting to look at this at subnational scales. Here's data for South America, Mesoamerica, and the connectivity in Africa. And ultimately enables us to chop up those regions into those areas that are more strongly connected than they are to their neighbouring communities. Just to finish off and highlight that this connectivity is changing things a lot. This is malaria in the 1930s. This is malaria today. In the 1930s, we had an air network that was perhaps not so efficient as today. It took 12 days to get from the UK to Cape Town. It was probably quite a long, high chance of dying along the route. Took 12 stopovers, I think. Today, we're in a much more connected world. And just to follow on from the previous talks, this is connectivity out of that Mekong region. To highlight that we are in a much more connected world and need to consider this in the ways that we design surveillance and eradication strategies. So I'm going to finish there and highlight that populations are highly mobile, and there's great heterogeneities between locations and time periods. And there's lots of local differences that we really need to account for. This translates into some challenges across a range of elimination settings and activities. Those four examples are just some that I pulled out, but there are many others. And some of the digital data that's becoming available, the genetic data on parasite mobility and methods for analyzing it to quantify and account for this connectivity are increasingly becoming available to guide these elimination activities. They're not the magic bullet, but they are another tool in our armory to help guide how we undertake these kind of activities. For example, if you were given 10 million, what would you do? This is another data source that can help. So this is not just me. There's multiple people involved in this in Southampton and around the world. So I will finish that. Take any questions. Thank you.
Questions around you, please.
One right in the middle, it's difficult for the microphone. Hi. You mentioned that there's a lot of problems with the vision. I guess you don't want to go into it forever, but is national borders and different phone networks a big problem, or is that not too bad?
No, that's a big problem. The operators only have to conform to the local regulation rules, so they do not measure if somebody goes across the border, and maybe they can measure that through roaming, but it's very expensive. So what we're increasingly doing is working with operators that do work on both sides of the border, and they record a handset ID, which can disappear from one side and appear on the other side, so you can get cross-border movements. It's much more difficult to coordinate between two operators, and there are, as you said, different operators. It makes it a headache as well. In Namibia, we have a 95% market share. We're pretty much getting most of the population. In some of these other countries, it's divided geographically and by market share. Richer populations prefer one network provider than others. But having said that, compared to the alternatives of small household surveys, of census migration data, it's still a fantastic data source, as long as we're keeping in mind those biases and uncertainties that exist.
It's very interesting talk and certainly mind-blowing in terms of the technology and use, especially of the anonymized data that would otherwise be lost in tech companies. But if you're looking at malaria, compared to NTDs, which affect the bottom billion, I suppose becoming bottom 2 billion now, does the bottom 2 billion or will they have mobile phone access, and can that be translated? I would argue not, but have you seen anything in relation to that?
I think we are increasingly comparing this to ongoing surveys in the field with ground surveys of phone ownership and usage, and it's going up and up and up. And we are seeing in some of the poorest communities individual phone ownership. I mean, there are places where it's one phone per house, but it's quite amazing. You will go to the most remote village. One of the first things that people want is a phone mast, or they want somewhere to charge their phone. Again, there are still areas in Democratic Republic of Congo, it's 70% penetration rate. So there are still 30% of the population that don't have phones, that don't have access to a phone, and that can be very biased to the poorest regions. So it's still not a perfect data set for sure.
What about using the phones for information? Is language an issue where sometimes you don't even know the language and it's not recorded?
So in this case, all we are working with is anonymized records of at this time point a call was made or received, or a text was sent or received, or they called this other anonymous individual. We are not working with any kind of content. We actually don't really want to work with content. It becomes a confidentiality nightmare of working out what was said and what was texted.
Thanks, Andy. That was a great talk. Just in relation to that, then, you can potentially infer types of interaction from movement data and things like that. Of course, the type of interaction influences spread of diseases. So have you got any examples of actually inferring different types of interaction and movement? Say if we had this data at the time you were trying to understand measles spread versus HIV outbreaks, you know, it could get very controversial analysis these really sorts of things, but you know, would we have the ability to pinpoint the sorts of interactions that are leading to this spread of diseases?
I think there's different spatial scales and temporal scales and of limits here. So in rural areas, we're limited by the spatial resolution, the density of the mobile phone towers. So we will maybe know we can't really get the kind of interactions that are going on there. Whereas in urban areas, it's a much more dense picture. So in those diseases that are where we're interested in spread through a rural area, I think that's feasible. And we can also get the kind of social network as well as the mobility as well. So who's communicating with who? So the two together, mobility and social network, I think gives quite a powerful tool for understanding some dynamics, depending on the disease. I mean, HIV is perhaps a very different disease, whereas measles, where it all depends on interactions, maybe it's more suitable perhaps.
Really excellent talk. Could you just talk a little bit about how easy it was to organise this? I mean, is this something you've done in collaboration, for example, in Namibia? Did you do it in collaboration with the mobile phone operator, or did you just go up to them and say, we want all of your anonymised data for that? And if you wanted to sort of just focus on a particular population, like you wanted to go to a particular city and know where residents of that city were moving. Do you think you could do it, or does this, the ethics of this rely on very large anonymized data sets where you can't really pinpoint any groups of individuals?
Okay, so it's changing fast in terms of data access and working with it. When we first started this, I think it was 2008 in Zanzibar, all it took really was the Clinton Health Access Initiative, the head of the malaria team at the time, Bruno Moonen, we were just able to tell him, can you go and knock on the door of the mobile phone operator and explain what we're doing with the malaria control program, and we were able to access the data. Since then, it's been a lot more coordinated approach working with the national control programs, which then they officially approach the operator, and it's very tight legal agreements. Increasingly, we're now moving to a model where the data is we know it's sensitive, and so the data never leaves, the raw data never leaves the mobile operator. We set up servers within the operator and process the data remotely, and only aggregated level data that we can share leaves. And in terms of being able to access individual cities, that's a good question. I mean, it tends to be easier for the operators themselves to just provide access to everything rather than them having to do geographical subsetting. We want to try and minimize the work it is for the mobile operators, but also ensure that the data is secure. So I can talk to you about the, and every single operator in every single country, the regulators are different in the way that they operate, and their level of sensitivity about these type of data.
Okay, I'm going to ask one more question and then let you off the hook, Andy, which is, because we've got our final talk of today on mobility issues, but can you give us your perspective on the usefulness of this data and accessing this data in public health emergencies?
Yes, again, it's something that's changing fast, and I think the Ebola outbreak highlighted perhaps how there isn't much of a coordinated approach at the moment, and that this data is still kind of new to the upper echelons who are coordinating global public health responses, and so there hasn't been much of an effort to coordinate. And the Ebola outbreak kind of showed that no groups really still have access to the data from the Ebola outbreak, despite the potential use of being able to show how populations are connected, how they're moving around, and perhaps to guide how surveillance could be undertaken. It looks like there's now a bit more coordination progress. We may be accessing some data finally from one of the affected countries, but
where the last case is now gone.
Yeah, it's too late, but maybe the next time, whenever the outbreak is.
Okay, so on that happy note, I'll